Has everyone done?
Really? Out of the room.
You put 19.
17. Messes up my demonstration. Huh. Okay. So we've done basically to create a histogram of your guesses, right? As you can see, so we get back to this later in the course. Today, we can see. You know, what that means. So I can tell something about all of you from what you chose, right?
This is welcome.
Yeah, Jesse can't do math, but the rest of you, you know, it's interesting. All right, so we're gonna do phylogenetics again. We're gonna talk about likelihood versus Bayes, model selection, and bootstrap. What all those mean, okay? First, I want to do you do a quick quiz, okay? Based on last time's work. Okay. If your laptop's not working, you can write on paper for right now. But in general, it's good to bring a laptop. Let me go to the URL. Okay, so some. SnipURL.com/ebcore2. Okay. That is Rhea. This works for me. Works for me. No. Shouldn't be. Here. Let me. All right, we'll come back to this then. It won't take too much time. We'll break and I'll fix it. All right. Rhea. All right, so today. Who's heard of Bayes' theorem? Okay, you good. Who's heard of likelihood? Okay, good. Model selection, Akiki information criterion. Okay, good. All right, and bootstrapping. Cool. Okay, that's pretty fast. I mean, you should have read it in the paper anyway, but yeah, maybe not outside of that. All right. So, coin flipping, always a basic example in stats, right? So, probability of landing heads is Q. What's a good estimate of that for this coin, right? And so this is a very simple question, okay? But depending on your statistical philosophy, you'll get very different answers, okay? So, a Bayesian answer one way, while a Frobenius would answer another way. Okay? And this matters in phylogenetics because we have different ways to get trees or to get answers about parameters. And depending on your philosophy, you could get a different answer depending on which method you choose. Okay. So first, let's do what a Frobenius using likelihood would do. Okay. So first, you choose a model. Okay. And so we're so used to coin flipping examples, we sort of have this default model we go to all the time, right? Some binomial model. where we say the probability of heads is independent of what the previous flip was, right? I can imagine other models. I can imagine a model where, you know, every flip is based on the reverse of the previous flip, right? Or if it's sunny, it turns out heads, right? If I'm at the Lincoln Memorial, it turns out tails. I mean, there's many models I could use for this coin flip, right? We'll talk about later on about how we choose between those models. Okay, right now, let's start with a model, create a model. And so our model is a binomial distribution. Okay, so now we have our model, and we have data. Two of the three tosses. Okay, now here's a bit of jargon that's worth knowing. Likelihood, so the likelihood of the hypothesis given the data is proportional to the probability of the data given the hypothesis. Okay. And so in our case, the hypothesis is given a value for Q. Okay. And the probability of landing heads is 0.5 or 0.6 or 0.1. Right? And the data, we're just getting two heads out of three tosses. And so, for example, if we set Q to 0.4, the probability of seeing two heads out of three tosses is plug and chug binomial formula, that. Right? Or you could do it another way and just say, you know, 0.4 is the probability of seeing two heads is 0.4 times 0.4 times 0.6. Right? You calculate it that way. And we get this is the likelihood. Right? And so we can say then that the likelihood of the positive Q equals 0.4, given the data, is proportional to 0.288. Okay. And this is actually equal to, okay. But in practice people can sort of drop constant multipliers from likelihood. So it might not actually be equal to, it's proportional to, but that's the basic way to get it. Okay, so all we're trying to do is maximize the probability of what we see given our parameter values. Right? And so luckily it takes, as the best estimate of Q, that value that maximizes the probability of the observed data. Right, so I have some data, and you know, I think, okay, what sort of model is most likely to get me what I see? Okay, the one that fits that best is likelihood. And so in our case, here's a likelihood curve, right? And so we could say, you know, if we have our value of Q of 0.4, that has this likelihood of 0.288. Okay. And the best value is here. That's the value with maximum likelihood. And we can look down and find out okay, that parameter estimate is 2/3. Okay. Intuitively, this makes sense, right? I find I get 2/3 heads. A good estimate for how probability of heads is 2/3. Okay. okay. And so that makes sense. But do you really think that's the case? Right. And so some of you did. Right. Some of you said, okay. We saw 2/3 heads, so out of 18, 2/3 is this. Right? Okay. The rest of you, you know, cannot do math. Like, why do something other than likelihood estimate? Right? What were you thinking? I have an object that gets 2/3. Time heads, that's all the data I have, right? So why don't you just estimate 2/3? What were you thinking there?
They have more data.
So. Where's the data coming from? They haven't seen this coin before.
Oh, they've never seen
that. It's just a coin I can show you that says, I mean, I could have whittled this down.
Every other coin.
Okay. So, right, so there's some sort of information floating out there that helps you with it. Right.
Also, I almost put 9 because it's impossible to observe 50% heads out of 3.1 flips. So the most likely scenario, if Q is actually 0.5, is 2 something and 1 something.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, I put 12, but that was my logic behind almost putting 9.
Yeah, okay. That was what people were thinking. The right reasoning. Okay, well, we'll get back to it. Alright, another issue with likelihood is it returns a probability of the data given the hypothesis. Right? I don't actually care about that. I have my data. What do I care the probability of it for? What I want to know about is probably my hypothesis is right. Right? That's what I want to do. Likelihood does not give you that. Okay, so it'd be cool if I had some method that would give me the probability of the hypothesis. Okay. And so to return this probability, we can use Bayes' rule. And Bayes' rule, Bayesian approaches can be controversial, right? Bayes' rule itself is not. Bayes' rule just comes from basic laws of probability. Okay? It works if I have probably A given B, given a sort of Venn diagram of probabilities. Right? So just basic rule, it's known. certain parts of its use here are controversial, to what it is. Right, so first we have this. So what's this? The purple thing? I mean, they give the hypothesis, right? Which is what? Likelihood, right. Well, look, you know how to calculate that, right? What's the red thing? What are the hypothesis? Given the data? Yeah. So probably of nothing, like given nothing, right? So you just walk into the problem and say, okay, the probability of my hypothesis is 5. Not 5. Very bad probability. 0.3. Right? And we call this the prior probability. So before I actually look at my data, I come up with a belief on my hypothesis. And let's see if I can hear. And I multiply those together. In the denominator, I do that across all possible hypotheses. Some of that across every possible hypothesis I have. Okay. Now, with coin flipping, of course, there's a continuous range of hypotheses, right? 0.4, 0.41, 0.401, 0.401, right? So I might not do this, I might do an integration, right? For tree space, if my hypothesis is a tree, we'll get a sum over all trees that are possible. Right? Is there a problem with that? It's a lot of trees, right? But figure out some way of getting around that problem. And we'll talk about that later, MCMC approaches. Okay? So that's Bayes' rule. Okay, and the cool thing is that if you do this properly, at the end we get out probably a hypothesis given the data. Right, so probably of the coin actually being a fair coin, given the data I have, and my prior beliefs about coin fairness. So, likelihood component is part of the Bayes' rule. Right, so, likelihood argument is maximizing this. Right? With Bayes, you think of it as estimating this. It's based on likelihood and the prior. Because they're related. They have the same model. You have a Bayesian coin flip example where I have a binomial model, just like a likelihood, also my prior belief floating around. Not quite. We'll talk about what we do in practice in a second. But in the same way, if I give you a certain tree and data, I get the likelihood of that. Just sort of use the likelihood approach. You get the same likelihood with the Bayesian approach. Right? But then slap in the prior and do some other stuff. The basic models are the same. Alright. So these priors, where do I get them from? Other data, previous experiments, expertise, blind guesses, right? What? Beauty. You just stick them in there, actually. So, I was referring to a program for phylogenetic inference called Beast, and the way you tell it what to do is you make a file using something called Beauty, and then it runs and runs and runs and crashes. And so, one prior could have is this orange one. That's there. I'm saying, you know what? I know nothing about coins. My prior belief would be 0.1 instead of being 0.5. I have no idea how coins work. Okay. And this is called an uninformative prior. So I'm not bringing any information from my prior. I'm saying I have no idea. Okay. I could say, hey, I know nothing about coins. Coins are usually fair. So you can put in this sort of blue prior.
I can say, a pretty strong weight is going to be 0.5.
Okay. I could have a prior like this, where I say, all right, I know that in stats classes, nothing's there the way it should be. Right? So another coin can't be fair. It has to be biased one way or biased the other. That's also a prior I could use. Now, for all these priors, we have the same likelihood. Okay? When we think about how we do Bayes' rule again, right? We have the prior times the likelihood normalized by a denominator equals the posterior. Right? The posterior probability. Probability of a hypothesis given the data. So here I've calculated that. Right?
So given my, my orange former prior,
if I
data to it,
right?
The maximum
is at 2/3. The data are driving. Okay. If I use my points of fair prior, I'm going to tell here that this is slightly to the right. Okay. Can actually put in the. And so here's the maximum of that posterior. Here's the maximum of this posterior, so slightly to the right, 0.5. This posterior, it's the maximum is no longer
here, and I'm pretty sure it's not over this part, right?
Okay. So three coin flips aren't a lot of data. Right, so the prior still matters a lot there. If they have more and more coin flips, then the prior should matter less, right? They keep flipping coin and always get 2/3 heads. At some point, these would all converge to the same shape. Okay. Not all priors would do that, though. So if I had a prior that said the coin must go from 0 to 0.5, then no matter how many times I flip it, I'll never get above 0.5. There's many priors like that. Another issue we have is there's not always an uninformative prior. Okay. And so you might say, okay, I don't want to put in my prior beliefs, I'll ignore that. But in the uninformative ones, there actually aren't always uninformative priors in phylogenetics. So for example, for branch lengths, there's no uninformative prior for branch lengths. So we'll get to that more later in the class. Any questions about this? That's fine, that's why we have the class for you. If you have a ton of data, you hope the prior doesn't matter that much. Right? You just want the data to drive it. But if you don't have a lot of data, I still want to get a good estimate. The prior can help with that. So the coin flipping case, I'm pretty sure the coin isn't 2/3 heads. Right? And so by having a prior near 0.5, you pull it that way. Yeah. Other questions about this? So you could try to do it as uninformative as possible. You could, as long as people do, is try different priors and see how much it depends on it, which is still philosophically kind of weird. Like, I'll change my prior beliefs about the universe and see how that affects things. But people aren't philosophically pure in this area. and they're mostly happy with that. Right? In practice, what a lot of people do is if they're using a Bayesian program that has defaults, they just use the defaults blindly. And you'll see that a lot with software in general. If there's a default setting, people use that and say, no, they know not to. Yeah. One thing you can do is if you can see how much your posterior resembles your prior. Right? And you can see if they exactly match up, then it either means your data don't contribute much, or that you were very smart ahead of time and knew what the true posterior would be. Right? Both those things do the same pattern. So if I flip the coin once, or it could be your data are sort of uninformative for some reason. But you have a lot of data, might be noisy or something. Other questions about this? That's good. All right, so where do you use priors? So you use priors in things like transition rates. What's really going from A to T or T to A in DNA? Okay. Rate heterogeneity. Right? So the rate at which redwoods evolve on the same rate at which mint evolves. Right? So you might have some prior about either putting a specific prior on that, or having a prior that rates can change over a tree. You put a prior on branch lengths. Okay, so when you turn a tree, what's like, you know, if we have no data about the tree, should we have some sort of non-zero branch length distribution? Okay, the birth death model or something like that. Put a prior on topology. Okay. So if the previous study shows that Umbrella is sister to all other angiosperms, right? And now I have another study where I have a new gene. So I may want to include their information by putting that prior in my analysis, rather than starting from scratch. Okay. Fossil calibration, yeah. You can consider that a very strong prior if you're generally working in a Bayesian framework. If you're doing, say, like a parsimony analysis, it's not really a Bayesian analysis trying to minimize the amounts of change on the tree, but you can still constrain it. So it's a sort of constrained optimization problem. I mean, the problem with this such a hard constraint is that no matter how much data you throw at it, you will never find something that rejects that tree. Okay. Fossil calibrations are important, right? So if I say, now, if I find the first triculpate pollen 2 million years ago, does that mean that's when that group of plants appeared, exactly at that point? We're born, fossilized. No, right? There's some uncertainty where, you know, the first ones that had that form probably evolved before that. Right? How much before that? Well, we don't know. Let's put a prior distribution on that. Maybe a log normal or something like that, or uniform. Because it has to be between 0 and 25 million years earlier than the first fossil. Make sense? Okay. And so we'll get to this more later in the semester, where we talk about when we're actually inferring trees, which ones to use. We also have an exercise later today about this too. Okay. It's something where for tree inference, based on just model speed, people are tending to use likelihood more than Bayes at this point. For trait evolution, it's such an estimation, correlations, it's a toss-up. You can use both. Okay. In your studies, you should be able to say why you're using a certain approach or not. And when if I'm in your committee, I'll ask you, oh, why are you doing it that way? Right? And there's arguments either way, right? You should at least know them. I'm on Sarah's committee.
That's
science. Yeah. No, I mean, in theory, you should have the reasons first. Yeah. This program runs fast. Okay, so that's all a situation where we have a given model, right? What if we don't know which model it should be? So we do model selection. Okay, and so I only have one model, which is probably a 0.5. That's my model. Kind of model is probably a 2/3. Okay. Another model where so it depends 0.5 plus improperly coin. Coin mass or the average mass of trees. If it's a heavy average coin, it tends to be plus more. Why? I don't know. Normal reported heads is 0.5 plus times coin orientation. As the coin's heads up, and I predict that my flip is to remain heads up. So, and so I can imagine different kinds of models. And so there are various ways to compare models. First of all, why do we care? So we're sure we can select models. Why should we bother figuring out what the best model is? Make different answers about what? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Alright, so could give answers about, say, if we're trying to estimate parameters, like probably of heads, then they could give different answers about that. If we're trying to predict more data later, could give different answers about that. Right. Maybe our hypothesis is about which model is best. Right? Maybe, you know, there are the people who think that coin orientation really matters. And people think, no, all that matters is the coin mass. And we take a fight over that. Right? For example, you could say, I think that floral symmetry matters in diversification rate. I think that flowers that are bilaterally symmetric speciate faster than flowers that are radially symmetric. Okay. an orchid speciates faster than a rose, something like that. Okay. And so we could fight over that. What that basically comes down to is a discussion about models. Which model is better? What fits the data better? We could solve that by picking the best model. Okay. And this is not just phylogenetics, this is ecology too. And so one method people use is the likelihood ratio test. Okay. And with that approach, you compare nested models. Okay. So there's nestedness. So models are the same except one of the models has parameters that are fixed. Right? So I could say, in my point case, one model is, you know, I probably have heads in a free parameter. Okay. Another model, probably Q, is 0.47. Right? This model is contained in this model. Right? If the best answer is 0.47, this model can get it. So this is nested in that model. Okay. If I thought that, you know, looking at human height, right? So you'd say one model is that male and females have the same height on average. Right? Another model is male and females can't have different heights. I mean, they must have different heights? No, but the model allows that to be the case. Right? And so the same height is nested within that multiple height model. Okay. Now if that's the case, we can compare the two models using like a ratio test. Just compare the likelihoods, use chi-square distribution, and see if the multiple models need to be better. And if you add in a parameter, is it worth doing so? Right. Or put the data better. Right. Or put the data a little bit better if you have more parameters and if the models are nested. Right. Is it significantly better? These costs? What could be problems with this? Right, some parallel models aren't nested. So in this case, none of these models are nested. Okay. They could be nested within, so given like a model E, that would probably have heads just being a free parameter, right? And they'd all be nested within that. Okay. But in general, you know, in this case, none of the models are nested, because we can't compare them using this approach. Okay. In some cases, we can. So this diagram is from a program called Model Test. We have models of how DNA evolves, and you can compare neighboring models. So one model has rate heterogeneity, one model has rate heterogeneity 6, so it's all equal. Right? You can compare those things. Right? One model has the proportion of sites that don't change being estimated, one has that fixed at them being 0. So you can compare those. Okay? And you can compare these fixed models. So one problem is, we need to compare nested models. Compare this one. This one, if you compare this one and this one, okay. you can also choose different models depending on which way you go. You can
go from the most complex, and simplest, and the next couple different places.
Okay. So this used to be the standard, but we don't do this sort of approach much anymore. Okay. Akiki information criterion. Okay. This is used more now. And the basic idea here is that this thing called the Akiki information criterion, you know, the score that estimates the distance between the models and the truth. This Kubler-Leibler distance. Okay. And it's like me as measuring the distance between me and Boston and Orlando and Boston. Right? So Orlando is, you know, about 15 feet closer than I am. Right? lucky you. Right? And so I don't know exactly how far we are from Boston. You know, is it 2,000 miles, 3,000 miles? I don't know. Right? But the 15 feet difference I can measure. Right? And so the idea is the best model is one that minimizes the amount of information loss. And we choose as a best model that between them. We can compare models. And the very nice thing about this is an estimator, this is an approximation. But as the estimates, you can calculate the estimates very easily. Right? Just twice the likelihood, it's twice the number of free parameters. Okay. and so we use that in many cases. The advantage of this is that it doesn't require nested models. Compare models that aren't subject to each other. Okay. Also allows model weighting. Right? Compare how much information is lost, you know, it's Orlando or me, and you can say, okay, so we should use 90% Orlando's approach and 10% my approach. Right? So rather than having a fixed, you know, we take the best model and ignore all the others. We use something called multi-model inference. Okay. one problem was this is an approximation. So we just published a paper where we looked at this in the phylogenetic context and found this approximation isn't always very good. Okay, so we're going to choose the wrong model. Okay. And there are a few other approaches we use for comparing models. We'll get to one of them, reversible jump MCMC, in a minute. Okay, I'm going to tell you what regular MCMC is. Okay. So we're talking about Bayes' rule. Figuring out what the numerator is easy, right? Likelihood times prior. The denominator is the sum of likelihood by prior for all possible models, or all possible hypotheses, right? That can be big. Right? And so there's a way to get, this is mentioned in the Lewis paper, right? And a way to approximate that. Okay. And basic strategy is like if I want to figure out what kind of hats you like to wear. Right? And so, Sarah's rolling her eyes. Okay. Oh, okay. Sorry? Right? So, what I can do is put you in a hat store and say, here's your algorithm for picking hats. Pick a hat at random, put it on your head. If you come to another hat that you like better, put it on. Okay. If you come to a hat that you like worse, if it's not that much worse, toss a coin, if it's heads, put it on. Okay? And walk around the store that way. Okay? And meanwhile, I have the store surveillance system videotaping me the whole time. Okay? And what we'll find is you can figure out from the frequency that you're wearing different kinds of hats how much you like them. Right? Do you wear red hats twice as much as brown hats? Do you wear cowboy hats one third as much as baseball caps? And so you allow them to sample the space, right? Without having to figure out the probability of each possible, like, how about a red cowboy hat versus a, you know, blue baseball cap with a spinner, right? I could, you know, integrate out over across all the hat styles and figure out how much you like red, how much you like spinners. Okay. I think, you know, you can think about various ways that could fail, right? So, for example, you could get stuck near the entrance, not visit the hats at the back. And take off, you sample the whole space, right? There might be some stupendous hat you love, right? It has nothing else near it you like. So if you have a hat that has a green brim and sequins and it glows, you love it. If it has, you know, a blue brim, you hate it, absolutely. So this narrow peak, It'd be very hard for you to get and sample that narrow peak. Okay. it could be hard for you to get from a good area to a bad area to create another good area. Right? So you think about if the surface is something like this, right? I could start off here and have trouble getting over to here. Right? Or vice versa, I could start off here and have trouble getting over here. Right? Remember, the denominator is over all the space. So if I'm not sampling this area, that's not good either. But I'm just trying to find the best one. I'm trying to figure out how much you like for different kinds to actually estimate that denominator. Okay. and so in file next, we have approaches to deal with this. Right? There's multiple chain, Markov chain Monte Carlo, MC cubed, where it's like this, where you have you walking around the store, but also you have a drunk friend who also walks around the store, the same preferences as you, but is a little more willing to try on crazy hats. Right? And the thought is that for that person, this is a shallower curve. Right? And so they're more likely to be able to hop the valley. And periodically you say to your friend, hey, what are you wearing? And if you like it, the more you can switch places with her. Okay. And so we use that for phylogenetics now sometimes too. Okay. And there's also, this is a very complex set of mechanisms to do. You can imagine various ways it could mess up. Okay. And so we have various diagnostics. We'll talk about those when we start running BEAST. Okay. but the cool thing is that when it does work, it allows you to sample the space and get this posterior probability without having to look at every single thing in the space, every single set of combinations. Okay, good. So a Markov chain is a memoryless process. Right? It's something where I go next depends on where I am, not where I was. So many things in life are like that. Right? Some things aren't like house prices. Right? I paid $220,000 for my house. I'm not going to, no matter what its book value is right now, I don't want to lose money on my house. Not when I sell it. And so the previous history affects what I do now. Right? Versus, how much money is in my bank account? Right? If I have, $10,000 now, whether it came from, $100,000 down to 10 or $5,000 up to 10, I mean, it's what I have now, and going forward, it moves up and down, and apparently what it was in the past. Monte Carlo means Vegas style, right? So Monte Carlo used to be, still is presumably, a place to go gamble, right? And so, rather than doing a careful analytical approach, you sort of try things. It's the whole strategy, moving across the space, which is like rolling the dice, moving around, that's Monte Carlo style. So Monte Carlo simulation, just gambling away. Okay, other questions about this? Okay. So reversible jump Markov chain Monte Carlo is similar, other than having one model where you choose different parameters, you have two different models. Okay. You move between two models. And just as with parameters in a single model, how much time you spend wearing a red hat versus a blue hat, here you have how much time you might spend in this model versus that model. And the time spent in those models give me some information about relative posterior probability of those models. And the cool thing is when I'm done with this, not only do I say, okay, this model's slightly better than that model, I actually say if I believe this is working properly, this model, 95% chance of being true. This model's a 5% chance of being true. Okay? Or other Bayesian parameters, This tree has a 20% chance of being a true tree than these other trees. Okay, which is why Bayesian parameters are appealing in many ways. Except for this issue of the priors coming. So if I go into my analysis thinking that Umbrella is sister to everything else, and you go in thinking that Waterloo is sister to everything else, we get very different answers coming in. I mean, how much the data are affected by the prior. And then we're sort of just arguing about prior beliefs, right? I can have a very strong prior that all of life is 6,000 years old, right? So I can throw tons of data in, and if my prior is strong enough, still 6,000 years old, maybe 6,001, right? We don't think it's that way, so we, it makes it a fight about prior beliefs.
You say time spent model, literally time spent by
Not quite. It's number of steps. These moves of like changing, trying different hats, we count those moves. So if, you know, this model takes longer to run, there's more things to calculate. No, that's fine. It's just, yeah. So if you know, if you put on a hat and it takes you a long time, like, oh, this is very nice. And if you put on a hat and you know, it's like, inside, it doesn't play a problem at all. Just the number of steps. There. Other questions about this? And of course, doing this approach, you get correlated results. Right? From the cowboy hat section, I'm looking at its cowboy hats. So you have to look around enough to be able to escape that. And as sort of put corrections in, you know, if I've sampled 1,000 hats, it'll just be, you know, equivalent to actually looking at 50 different completely independent hats. Because the hats that neighbor each other are correlated with each other. Right? It takes a while to move away from that correlation. Same thing with trees or other parameters. Right? If my probability of heads is 0.5, and next try 0.51 and 0.49, those are next to each other for a reason. They're similar. And it actually be sampling specific to move further. And so I might have, so I'll have a smaller effective number of samples, effective sample size, ESS, than the actual number of steps I've taken. Okay. Questions about this? Okay. Bootstrapping. So back in the Dark Ages, 1985, it is rare that any attempt is made to put a confidence interval on an estimate of a phylogeny. Most methods yield one or a few trees, and you've really gone to examine the variation of the trees that come out. Okay. There's no reason to believe this practice constitutes an adequate exploration. Okay. What does that mean? So I'm doing my tree search, this crazy tree space we talked about, and it comes out and says, this is the best tree. I say, that's great. What's the next best tree? I don't know. You know, it could be that the next best tree is far, far worse than this tree. So I have lots of confidence this is the right tree. Or it could be the next best tree is a tiny bit worse, right? Maybe you have a whole bunch of trees that are all about the same. Right? That means something nice to know. You know, trees have been used, for example, in court cases. You know, did a dentist give his patients HIV? Right. And you want to know that the tree you get that shows that he did is known with confidence, right? Because the guy's going to jail. Right. So you need to have some sort of good measure of this to do your science work. All right, what were some problems? Well, we have some unknown distribution, right? So we're doing binomial. Okay, well, I know binomial. So Wikipedia, what the confidence interval is. Okay, use that. Plug and chug. Right? How about for a tree? That's harder to do. Okay. and so here our data are, say, sequences. Okay. So I observe an A for humans at this site, and a T for chimps at this site, and a T for bonobos at this site. And then next site, and next site, and next site. So it's line data of that sort. Okay. And what I could do is pull samples from that distribution. So I'll take site 1, and I'll take site 3, and I'll take site 1 again, and make a new replicate data set. Okay. And so I can take that as a way of creating a new data set from the same sort of a model. Say, okay, I have this new data set. How similar is the result I get from this new data set as from the old data set? If with the subsampling get the same result each time, it suggests that I have pretty good confidence in this result, right? If just by chance just sampling one of character 3 instead of 2 of character 3 completely changes my result, I'm not confident, just based on a few characters in one character. Okay? This approach is known as non-parametric bootstrapping. We use them in phylogenetics, we use them in other things too. Right? So paleontologists want to figure out, you have a bunch of leaves and they occur at this time periods. What's the uncertainty in the total duration of that group? We could bootstrap some leaves with replacement and get an idea of what that confidence should be. Because it's a general stats method that Felsenstein is famous for bringing into phylogenetics, among other things, even half a field. Okay. So imagine here I have two true distributions. Okay. And I can pull empirical samples from them. That distribution, and so the mean's there, right? And I do the same thing for this distribution. Look, hours are similar, and get that mean there, right? And do this many times. So that's my empirical sample, and I'm subsampling from that sample, right? So that's the truth. We can't end the loop. We can't see it. What we have is an empirical data. And so I just resend from the empirical data. So this one sent it once, this one sent it twice, this one doesn't send it at all, this one sent it once, this one two times. Okay, during a new data set. Okay, and they get my new mean. And same thing here. New mean there. Okay, that's one bootstrap rep. I could do another. You get a new mean, and from this other one, same thing. New mean, and repeat many times. Okay. Now again, I don't know what the truth is, so I can't see that. But even though I don't know the truth, you know the estimates for the first set are more precise.
This resampling
procedure, I learned something about this distribution. What it means is more confident than this one, there was a mutual. Okay. And so using the tree case as well. So imagine I have, you know, these empirical samples, right? I might then, I'll choose this column, this column, this column, this column, this column again, a new data set. For a tree, using one of the various methods we talked about, and then compare the trees. Right? And here, the trees might all be very similar. Right? Here, the trees are radically different.
Okay.
And so, yeah. And you analyze which one is exactly the same way. And if sometimes you can find out that this data set has more confidence in its trees. You might find that, you know, most of the tree is known well, but this one part of the tree, relationships change based on which the characters I choose. So then that part of the tree is known for less certainty. Are there questions about that? So bootstrapping is sampling with replacement. So I have 1,000 characters, I sample and get another 1,000 characters. That means some of my original characters are sampled twice, some once, some not at all. Jackknifing, I sample each character no more than once, sampling without replacement. So I go down to have, you know, 70% of the characters, 30% of the characters. There have been studies done to see which one's a better estimate of confidence, and I believe bootstrap one of those. So, could we use Bootstrap? The conventions use Bootstrap. Within the cladistics community, for a while they were just doing jackknifing with anything. Now they're actually doing Bayesian approaches too. So, one of the religious wars in phylogenetics for a while was between people who use parsimony only, people who use models. And the parsimony only people were thinking that, you know, based on Karl Popper's philosophy of science, science should be about falsifying hypotheses, right? And so each character can sort of reject the hypothesis about what the tree can be. And that's the proper way to do science. And then The other side was saying, okay, well, we have this models for evolution, let's use actually a model, and we can model based inference. We'll talk later about Lombard's attraction and things like that that relate to which approach works better. Okay. It wasn't just about which works better, it was also based on someone really cared about the philosophy of how to do science well, and others didn't in the same way. And both groups still persist. Most work now is done under the general, like, you know, use models approach. There's still a minority that uses just parsimony or narration and base approaches to. Okay. So this is one way of getting confidence. A different way is to use Bayesian approaches, right? So talking about the MCMC, right? If we're looking over our model space includes the tree, right? I could say this tree was found 95% of the samples, or 30% of the samples. So the posterior probability of that tree is 30%. Okay. Or out of all the trees, 70% of them had this clade. Okay. So this clade has 70% of posterior probability. Okay. And so it's a different approach to getting at this confidence. Okay. and so just to compare them, so Bayesian approaches use the original data. And you could also bootstrap a Bayesian approach, right? You could do a Bayesian approach with bootstrap data sets many, many times. It's going to already take days, and no one does it. But you could. So Bayesian uses original data, bootstrap uses resample data. Maybe you get a set of trees, bootstrap you also get a set of trees, right? Maybe you get probably alternate trees, right? So you see this tree has 70% cluster probability. We also look to see, does one tree have the remaining 30%, or is it split across 10 trees evenly? Under the information about conflicting characters, conflicting information. Agent gives support for 95% with just one character. Right, so I have a data set. That is, so forth. And then I have A, T, T, A. Right, so only one character that has information about relative relationships. With the Bayesian approach, that could give you enough support to have lots of support from trees. Because right? I always see that character. How likely is it that that change happened twice? Very unlikely. Because right? Change is so infrequent that to have two changes causing homoplasy is rare. So the Bayesian approach would say, oh, there's only been one change. And so it gives it the same tree all the time. Whereas bootstrapping, you know, sometimes they choose that character, sometimes they don't. If they don't, I just have, you know, random set of trees. Okay. And so with bootstrapping, you need to have at least three characters that okay. Cultural issues. So if you have a tree that has 95% posterior probability on the edge, that's going to be a good support for that, Bayesian. Bootstrapping, okay. So it relates to, we're looking at the early empirical data sets. You know, I think this is right, and it has this much support for one method and different support for different method. Okay. This requires that you do Bayesian. This you can do with parsimony, you can do distance, you can do with Bayesian if you want to. So it's more general. One jargon note. So in this context, when we say bootstrapping, we mean non-parametric bootstrapping, the sampling and replacement thing. If you talk to a statistician, he will often interpret bootstrapping as parametric bootstrapping, where we simulate data according to some model rather than resample the data. So again, making up new data sets, but doing it by simulations with parameters rather than doing this non-parametric sampling. Okay. And we do this somewhat in Falcon Devs, not that much. And most users don't do that. Okay, questions about that? So how does this relate to our example here? So we'll whole like likelihood based thing. Right. So people here thought it was exactly 9. If you have data that suggests it's 2/3 heads, you say I have really strong prior that it's coins are fair. I'm going to stick my values here. People here say I have a pretty strong prior that it's fair, but it's not so strong that you know 3 data points can't affect it. Right. So we can go a little higher. And it's just the strong prior for coins being unfair. Right. But here, you know, if you think about this doing you know 2 slightly different priors. And so oftentimes when you run into a class like this, you find that the vast majority of people for coin flipping are Bayesians with a strong prior. Right. Why might that be? Mm-hmm. Right. So you think you know something about coins, right? If I had the same data and I said it came from an R function I just wrote that you know nothing about, you might then say, okay, I have no prior knowledge about how Brian writes an R function. Maybe it's programmed to give 2/3, maybe it's programmed to give 1/2. I don't know. So I'll have a very flat prior guess. Any questions about that? And again, this distinction between frequentist approaches and Bayesian approaches comes up again and again. Doing conservation planning, right? You bring in prior information as a prior or not. You just have the data as the real driver. If you're doing an ecological study, do you bring in, I think that competition is important in the system. Do you bring that in with a prior about competition, or do you just infer without the prior and then compare it to previous results? So this is broadly important. Okay. All right, let's take a quick break, 5 minute break. You know, I'll flip the coin so we can see who wins. Livelihood wins. So if you are one of these four, take four. No more than four candies, otherwise take one, no more than three. If you let it right, take no more than four. If you let it wrong, take no more than three.
What was the answer?
Oh, so sorry, if you're within one. So it Perkins was 11. All right. So those who were strict this that close, and those who are Dajians.
Does it just taste a little bit of each one to know if that's not a lot?
Exactly.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, yeah, it's using methods that incorporate a prior, right? And sometimes you have to use MCMC, sometimes you have to use other things. Sometimes you have to use hyper priors. So if you know what a prior could be, would you put a prior on the prior? Why not? But yeah, low vision. And it's follow, sorry.
Like, there's a chance that you're not 11, no matter which.
Right, right. I mean, so you could compare, you know, what's the probability of getting 11 given this model versus that model? Right. Other questions about this? Okay, so let's go on to computer exercise. By the way, one thing that's cool, so we're talking about how with AIC you can get the weights, various things. If you Google Akike weight, the top hit is me on Google. I'm really proud of myself. That's something because I actually wrote it because I couldn't remember what the function was for it, so I just wrote a quick little web page to keep track of it. And now it's the top hit. So that's my claim to fame in science. All right. So we have an exercise.